Thank you. So the goal and the structure of the second course will be the following ones. We will still work on control-affine systems with scalar input. And we will prove necessary conditions for small-time local controllability formulated in terms of Lie brackets of the vector fields F1 and F0 evaluated at zero. Okay, I will focus on necessary conditions because for sufficient conditions, there already exist powerful results in the literature, for instance, by Sussman, by Agrachev and Gram-Kelitz. But there is more need to prove necessary conditions. Okay, and I will have two objectives. First, to develop techniques to prove necessary conditions for ODEs, but also to prepare a transfer to the study of PDEs. Okay, so I will search for techniques that will be that we will be able to adapt to PDEs. Okay, so I will start by defining Lie brackets and present a new representation formula for the state X of the control system. Then I will prove two necessary conditions just to present the general approach. And then I will explain how it was extended to a PDE with the example of the bilinear Schrödinger equation. Okay, so we start with the definition of Lie brackets. So if you have two vector fields F and G on Rn, you can define another vector field, the bracket of F and G, which is defined by F prime G minus G prime F. Okay, and then you can divide by induction iterated Lie brackets of F and G. Okay, if F and G are linear vector fields associated with matrices A and B, then the Lie bracket of the vector fields F and G corresponds to the commutator of the matrices A and B. Okay, so the Lie bracket measures the lack of commutativity between motions. Okay, so there are several reasons. Okay, so sorry. So it will be very convenient to have some notation. So the goal of this slide is to introduce this notation, and I will use them massively in the rest of the talk. So it's important that you memorize them. Okay, so X, I will call capital X the set of two non-commutative indeterminates, X0 and X1. Okay. That will play the role of the vector fields F0 and F1. But at this level, we do algebra, and X0, X1 are just indeterminates in polynomials. Okay? Then I call A of X the free algebra over X. It is just the vector space of non-commutative polynomials in the variables X0 and X1. So for instance, this polynomial of X0 and X1 is an element of A of X. Okay, so this is the vector space of polynomials in X0 and X1. Then inside this vector space, I define a subspace L of X called the free Lie algebra, which is the smallest vector space of A of X, which contains the letters X0 and X1, and which is stable by the Lie bracket commutate by the Lie bracket operation. Sorry. So inside L of X, you have all the iterated Lie brackets. Sorry. And you also have linear combinations of those iterated Lie brackets. Okay, sorry. Okay, so an example of element of L of X is this linear combination of Lie brackets. It will also be convenient to have the functions N0 and N1 defined on iterated Lie brackets B, which are elements of L of X, and which count the number of occurrences of the variables x0 and x1 inside B. Okay, so for instance, if B is this bracket, then n0 is 1 because x1 is involved once in B, And N1 of B is 2 because X2 appears 2 times in B. Okay? And so now we have this space L of X of the freely algebra, a vector space spanned by formal Lie brackets of X0 and X1. So in this space, we do algebra, but we can evaluate each element of this space inside vector fields just by replacing the letter X0 and the letter X1 by the vector fields F0 and F1. So for instance, any B in the free Lie algebra can be evaluated as a vector field that we will call F subscript B, and this notation will be very important. Okay, so I will call F subscript B the vector field that you associate with B by replacing X naught by F naught and X one by F one. Okay, so for instance, if B is X one X naught, then you associate then FB is F one F naught. Okay. And then once you have a vector field, you can evaluate it on zero and get a vector. Okay, so I will use many times this notation F subscript B of zero, where B is an element of the free Lie algebra. Okay. Okay, so the first reason why we focus on Lie brackets is that we have the very well-known Lie algebra rank condition. Okay, so for two vector fields F0 and F1, the Lie algebra rank condition states that if you take the Lie algebra generated by F0 and F1 and you evaluate it on x equals 0, then you span Rn. Okay, this means that the vector fields, the evaluation at 0 of the vector fields that you build by bracketing F0 and F1 as many times as you want spans Rn. Okay, so this Lie algebra rank condition is known to be a necessary and sufficient condition for the local controllability of driftless systems. So by driftless, I mean that I put a control in front of any field. So for x not equal u not f1 f not plus u1 f1, the Lie algebra rank condition is a necessary and sufficient condition for local controllability and also small time local controllability, and actually also for smooth small time local controllability. This point you do not know because the usual proof uses piecewise constant controls, which are not smooth. But if you look carefully at the proof of the implication, when we prove that the Lie algebra rank condition implies the local controllability, the proof uses piecewise controls u0 and u1, and when u0 is 1, u1 is 0, and reversely. Okay, so and you have a maximal number of switches. Okay, so finally, it's very easy to smooth the control. So instead of taking piecewise constant control, just you it's a time of if you change the parametrization of the time, you get the same final point with a smooth control. Okay. Okay, so for driftless control systems, the Lie algebra rank condition is a necessary and sufficient condition for smooth STLC. And the reason why is that if that the sorry, formally, the solutions of the ODE live in a submanifold and on which at for which at each point the tangent space is the evaluation at point X of the Lie algebra spanned by F0 and F1. So if you want the solutions to fill in the whole space, you need this tangent space to be Rn. Okay, so this is for driftless system. When you consider systems with drift, then the Lie algebra rank condition is a necessary condition for small state, small time local controllability. But it is well, it it and it requires but this implication requires analyticity of the vector field. For instance, for this system, you do not have the Lie algebra condition, but it is locally controllable at zero. Okay, but so it is a necessary condition, but it is not sufficient. For instance, here you have a very simple system for which you have two brackets which generate Rn after evaluation on f and on zero. And nevertheless, the system is not controllable because you cannot control the second component, it is always positive. Okay, so with this system, you see that among all the brackets, some of them seems to be bad because associated to motions in only one direction and not in the other one, like the bracket W1 here. But some other are good. For example, the bracket X1 here is good because you can move in both directions the system. Okay, so for systems with drift, the Lie algebra condition is necessary, but it is not sufficient. And inside all the Lie brackets, we would like to know which ones are good and which ones are bad. Okay, this is a splitting problem. Okay. Okay, another reason why we look for conditions formulated in terms of Lie brackets is that we have a very fundamental result proved by Kreener, which is the following one. If you consider two affine control systems with the same control, okay, the trajectories of the first one are diffeomorphic to the trajectories of the second one, if and only if the evaluation at zero of their Lie brackets have the same vectorial structure. So by vectorial structure, I mean the same kernel, the set of Lie brackets that vanish at zero for F are the same as the Lie brackets that vanish at zero for G. Okay? So this for in some sense it is very easy. So if you have diffeomorphic systems, then you have a relation between the vector fields of the F and the vector fields of the G's, and it's easy to get the second statement. Okay, what is difficult is to prove that if you have the same vectorial structures on the evaluation at zero of the Lie brackets, then the two systems are diffeomorphic. And Kreener's proof is the following one. You may assume that for X you have the Lie algebra Rank condition. Okay, believe it. So you can consider n Lie brackets, n elements of the free Lie algebra that after evaluation on F and on zero span the whole space for X, okay? For the system with X. Okay? This allows you to define local coordinates, like I'll call alpha 1, alpha n, just by choosing a representation of on a point X in RD as a product of flows. Okay? The fact that you have the Lie algebra Rank condition ensures that this function of alpha is a local diffeomorphism of Rn at zero. So these local coordinates do exist. Okay, and then for a point X, you have co new coordinates and you apply the same coordinate to the other vector fields, the G's. Okay, and this gives you the diffeomorphism. Okay, so then you need to prove that it works. And the proof is quite simple, actually. It relies on a very famous conjugation formula. Okay, so this very fundamental result proves that all the information about small-time local controllability is contained inside the evaluation at zero of the Lie brackets. Okay? Because okay, if two systems have the same vectorial structure of these sets, then they are diffeomorphic, so they have the same small-time local controllability properties. Okay. So now we start the study. Okay, and to prove necessary conditions, I will use a new representation formula for the state. And my goal now is to present you this formula. So we proved it in a joint work with Jérémy Le Bon, who is algebraist, and Frédéric Marbach, who is from analysis and control theory. Okay, and it takes the following thing. So if you take the solution of a control affine system, you can approximate it by a sum, okay, that involves awesome that ranges over elements B of a basis of L of X. So L of X is a vector space. It has a basis. Okay, it is an infinite dimensional vector space, but it has an algebraic basis. Okay, so here you sum over the elements of a basis of L of X, and inside the sum, what do you have? You have coordinates, eta b of tu, that depends only on time and u, so they are universal, they do not depend on the system. And then you have the Lie brackets evaluated at zero. So here you have the so on the eta of t and u, you can do analysis. The quantity depends only on time and u. And then here you have geometry. You have the Lie brackets evaluated at zero. Okay? So you can approximate x by some sum, such a sum, on which you really clearly see the Lie brackets, and in front of them, coefficients, components. Okay? Of course, there are reminders that you will have to deal with, and a small o of x. Okay? So we need to deal with reminders because the complete sum, in general, does not converge, even with analytic vector fields. And so we have to consider truncations of this sum that may be infinite but convergent. Okay. And then we have to deal with the associated reminder terms. For some choice of reminder, we may have here sums that converge only for very well chosen bases, but actually the only known bases of L of X are called whole bases, and for these whole bases we prove that the sums that appear in our formula always converge, so the dominant part here always converge. So an important fact about this formula is that it is not at all a Taylor expansion, because if you take the Taylor expansion of X with respect to the control U, you get a formula which is not naturally expressed on the Lie brackets. Okay? This is why we derived this other representation formula. Okay? And the difference between the Taylor expansion and this formula is that here you have a small o of X, and inside this small o of X, something is hidden, which corresponds to the terms that were not Lie brackets inside the Taylor formula. Okay, so this is a quite subtle formula. It is obtained as a consequence of the Magnus formula, and it is not a Taylor expansion. It is something more subtle. And I will not explain you how we get this formula because I prefer to explain you how we use it. And if I convince you that it's very nice to use this formula, maybe you will be okay to learn how to get it. Okay, so how do we prove necessary conditions with this formula? So here I wrote the complete form, a complete admissible form of this formula. So I expressed the reminders. So, if you take a basis of L of X and inside the basis you call B1M the elements for which the number of occurrences of X1 is smaller than M, okay, then you index the sum by this set, and you with this very precise choice of indexes here, the remainder is some power of the norm of a norm of the control. So precisely, it is the power m plus one. So here you have all the terms that involve the x1 at most m time. Okay, and each time you have x1, it means it's a term in the dynamics that involves f1, but in the system, f1 and u appear at the same time. The system is x naught equal f naught plus u f1. So each time you have f1, you have u. Okay, so here you have terms which are of order at most m with respect to u. Okay, and then you have a remainder which is of order m plus one with respect to u. Okay, and the norm here is a weak norm. It's the LM plus one. It's an LP norm of the primitive, the first primitive of U. Okay, so for scalar input systems, we have here a very weak reminder quantified in a weak norm of U, which is an LP norm of its primitive. Okay. Okay, so now we have this formula that we understand, and a natural strategy to prove a necessary conditions could be the following one. So we will choose a bracket B in the index set such that the functional eta B is signed for T small. By signed, I mean that for any U, it takes either always positive or either or always negative values. Okay, so we will choose a B for which here we see a component which is positive, which corresponds to what we observed on particular systems. Okay. So let us assume that such a B does exist with a positive coordinate here for any U. Then we will choose M such that this reminder be negligible with respect to the positive quantity that we ch chose. Okay, and then by projecting on the vector FB of zero, parallelly to all the other vector fields that appear in this sum, we will get a formula. The projection along this vector field of X will be eta B plus negligible terms, negligible either with respect to the coordinate, either with respect to X, because here you have something that depends on X, okay? And such a formula prevents motions of the form X equal minus epsilon FB of zero, because here you would have well, let us assume that eta B is positive. Here you would have minus epsilon, something positive, okay? So minus epsilon greater than something which is negligible with respect to epsilon, which is not possible. Okay? Okay, so this is a very natural way that we may think to prove necessary conditions. Okay? So a drawback of this approach is that whatever the basis of the free algebra B you choose, in general, the coordinates here are not signed. Okay, so if you choose any basis, the coordinate here that appears has not a simple form. It is a sum of two parts, a principal part, which is quite explicit in the sense that it can be computed by induction on the whole basis. And another part, which are cross terms of other coordinates of the second kind. Okay. And okay, so the expression is not simple, and the coordinates are not signed. But what we observed is that if we choose very well the basis B of the free algebra, we can see signs on the principal parts. Okay? So this is, for example, the case for the most famous Bad Lie bracket that we will study later. We have a principal part, which is the integral of the square of the first primitive of U. It is a principal part which is positive. And then you have cross terms, the first primitive of U times the second primitive of U, cross terms. And the sum of both has no sign, but if you forget the cross term, you have a sign, okay? And all the work will be to deal with the cross terms and the remainder to make the positive term win, okay? So this naive strategy does not work and needs to be completed. And our unified approach is actually the following one. So we start with a representation formula of X. Thanks to the coordinates of the second type, those that are quite explicit and on which we see nice signs if we choose very well the whole basis, plus cross terms, plus a reminder. Okay. Okay. So we will start with this formula and do the following, execute the following program. So first we choose B, an element of the basis for which the coordinate here is signed. Let us assume it is positive. Okay. Then we will find a name. It will be a norm. Okay. Let us think that it will be a norm to the square, to the fourth. Okay. Then we will find M, the cut here, such that the remainder here be negligible with respect to the functional psi b. In the asymptotic, t goes to zero and u goes to zero in the norm we are working with. Okay, so at this moment, we are looking for interpolation inequalities. Okay, to bound the remainder by the drift psi b times something that will be small, and small because it will depend on the choice of the limit. Okay, so now we have choose B, we have choose M, and we have to deal with cross terms. Okay, and we need to prove that the cross terms are negligible with respect to the other terms in the formula. And this does not happen in general. In general, cross terms are not negligible. We have examples on which we can prove that they are not negligible in general, but under appropriate algebraic assumption, we can deal with them. Okay, so in particular, if you assume that the vector field FB is not spanning, the evaluation at zero of FB is not spanned by the other terms of the sum, then you can prove that these cross terms are negligible with respect to the other terms. Okay, so at this step, I will execute the program later. Maybe you will see more clearly. But at this step, we will prove a closed loop estimates of the cross terms and also interpolation inequality to conclude. Okay, so I will execute these programs on two examples, and I think that at the end, it will be more clear. Okay, so first, I need to give you the elements of the our basis B star of the free algebra and the associated coordinates of the second kind, so that you can observe that we can read the things on them. Okay, so we prove that there exists a basis of the free algebra for which in which the elements for which n1 equals 1, the elements which involve x1 only once, are of the form x1 0 nu. So by x1 0 nu, I mean that I write bracket x1 by x naught nu times. Okay, so these Li brackets form a basis of the layer in L of X corresponding to the brackets which involve x1 only one time. Okay? And for any such element, the coordinate of the second type is some integral of the control. Okay? So for x1, you have u1, the first primitive of the control. For the bracket of x1 and x0, you have u2, the second primitive of the control. Okay, if you bracket x1 by x0 two times, you get u3, the third primitive of the control, etc. So here you observe linear terms in u that you can simultaneously control. It's very easy. It is a solving polynomial moment problems on the control. Okay, so now then you have the layers in the basis on which the layer of brackets that involve x1 two times. Okay, and if you define these elements, okay, so you can take two MJs and you bracket them together, you get a bracket which involves x1 two times, and then you write bracket them by x naught an arbitrary number of time. Okay, and you get elements, you get formally brackets, and they form a basis of this layer in the free algebra. Okay? And for each such element, the associated coordinate of the second kind is the integral of some primitive of the control to the square times some power of t. Okay, so here you see that you have a sign. All of them are signed. Okay, this is a strong indication of that the first bracket will be good, and we know that because they are associated to linear terms. Okay, and all the second ones will be bad because associated to sign coordinates. Okay, so of course we could continue, and I could give a name to each element of the basis, but I will stop here because I will not use them, not in this course. Okay, so my goal is to present you the proof of two necessary conditions that are not the best one in the literature, but that are quite easy to present. Okay, and that capture the main difficulty. Okay, so we will prove that if a system is L infinite STLC, then the bracket FW1 of 0, okay, so W1 is x1, x1, x0. Okay, so this bracket, the first bad bracket, quadratic bad bracket, has to be spanned by brackets that involve x1 at most two times, okay? So we will prove this fact. So what does it mean? It means that if you have a system like this one, x1 dot equal u, x2 dot equal x1 square plus some nonlinear term. So if you forget the nonlinear term, you have a system which is not controllable because of x1 square that creates a drift. And the meaning of this necessary condition is that here you need to put a term which is either for the system to be controllable, you need to put a term which is either linear corresponding to n1 equal 1 or quadratic corresponding to n1 equal 2. Okay, and in particular, a cubic term will not be sufficient to prove L infinite STLC. Okay, so this is the meaning of this first necessary condition. And then we will look at the second bad bracket, in second quadratic bad bracket, W2, okay, which is x1 0, x1 0 square, sorry. Okay, and we will prove that it is necessary for L infinite STLC that it be spanned by brackets involving x1 at most three times. Okay, so for instance, in this system, x1 dot equal u, x2 dot equal x1, sorry, it is a typo. Here it is x1, x3 dot equal x2 square minus w1 minus x1 4. So here you have w2. Okay, and here I put a nonlinear term which is of order 4, and this necessary condition proves that this term of order 4 is not sufficient. Okay? So such a system is not L infinite STLC, okay, as a consequence of the theorem that we are going to prove. Okay, so I start with the first one, and then I prove the second one. Okay, so we want to prove that for the system to be L infinite STLC, it is necessary that FW1 of 0 be spanned by brackets involving x1 at most two times. By other brackets involving x1 at most two times. And we will work by contradiction. So we assume that FW1 is not spanned by this space. Okay, so we are in RD, in RN. In RN, we have a vector FW1 and a vector space. And the vector does not belong to the vector space. So we can introduce a projection along this vector with parallel to this vector space. Okay? And we are going to apply this projection to our representation formula. Okay? Okay, so I wrote here the representation formula I presented before with m equal 2. Okay, so if you do that, so you apply the projection to X, so you have to apply the projection to the first term, but the choice of the projection makes that it projects any FB of 0 to 0 except the one for B equal W1. Okay? The choice of projection makes that. So the full sum here is projected only on the coordinate associated to the bracket W1. And then you have the same reminder. Okay? So now I am going to explicit the coordinate eta W1, okay, with the coordinate of the second kind, which is positive, and then a cross term, and then the same reminder. Okay? So now we have to think about the cross term. And here I use the famous inequality AB is smaller than A square plus B square, okay? Because A2 of T square is small when the time T is small with respect to the drift here. Okay, it is bounded, so U2 of T gives U2 square, which is smaller than T times the integral of U1 square. Okay, so with just that, we obtain the last line. So here we have something which is very nice because when the time is small and the control is small in this norm, then this term can be absorbed by this one, okay? And this term is not a problem. So the only problem is with u1 of t square. So here you have a quantity which has no functional reason to be negligible with respect to the drift. Okay? So, and you want to absorb it by the drift. Okay? So it will not be for functional analysis reason, because it is false in general. In general, you have functions for which this quantity can be very large and this quantity very small. Okay, so you may think you have a problem, but actually, it's not the case because you are looking at a system, and all the, many things are interdependent in a system. Okay, and what I'm going to prove in the next slide is an estimate of this term by higher order terms that will allow to prove that it is negligible in the same way as this guy. Okay, so in the next slide, my goal will be to prove a higher order estimate on u1 of t. Okay? Okay, and actually, I will prove a closed loop estimate because I will have a higher order estimate. So I will u1 of t is of order 1 with respect to u. I will estimate it by a quantity of order 2 with respect to u. And the price to pay is that it will be a closed loop estimate. So x will go back. Okay? But it will not be a problem at the end. Okay, so how do we get that? So we deduce from the assumption that we did, this assumption that the bracket FW1 at zero is not spanned by the vectors by the evaluation of zero of this bracket. We deduce, it's an exercise, that this from this assumption that the vector FM0 at zero is not in the vector space spanned by the FMG at zero for g greater than one. Okay? Okay, this is an exercise. This is very easy. So you can introduce again a projection along the first bracket, the first vector parallel to the vector subspace. We are in Rn here. And you can apply this projection to the representation formula that I wrote here for m equal 1, and I explicited here the eta b. So when you do that, so you project x. When you project the sum, you get the term that corresponds to fm not of 0, which is u1, and all the other terms are projected to 0. Okay? And then you have the remainder. And if you look at this formula, it's easy to deduce that u1 of t is estimated, which is linear in U, that you actually can be estimated by a quadratic quantity in U, U1 in L2 to the square, plus X. Okay, this is what we call closed loop estimate because U is estimated by something of higher order and also with X. Okay, so now we are going to put everything together. So in the first slide, I proved this estimate and I had a problem with the U1 of t. Then I proved on U1 of t a closed loop estimate by higher order terms. And then if I put the second estimate in the first one, I get this new estimate, which is very nice. Because in the remainder, you have, so here you have a drift. In the remainder, you have the drift time some quantity, which is small if the time is small and the control is small in this norm. And then you have hex, which is not a problem to conclude because such an estimate prevents motion of the form x of tu equal minus epsilon fw1 of 0. Because if such motion were possible, you would have minus epsilon on the projection here. You would have something positive here that absorbs the first part of the remainder. So after absorption, still something positive, okay? And here something which is greater than minus some constant epsilon to the 3 over 2. So a contradiction, okay? Okay, so this is the proof of the first quadratic obstruction that I proposed. So I choose a necessary condition quite easy to prove in three slides, but it's not the best one. And actually, you can refine this proof, estimate more terms inside, and prove that actually for small time local controllability, it is for W minus one infinite STLC, so a weaker notion of STLC, it is necessary that W1 be spanned by linear terms. Okay? It is a Okay, so what we proved is not exactly that, but by refining the proof, estimating more terms inside our representation formula, we can prove that. And actually, we can also generalize it to any order and prove Stefani's necessary condition that W minus one infinite STLC implies that this bracket of order 2L with respect to F1 be spanned by terms of lower order with respect to F1. Okay, it is the same idea at another order. Okay, so now I'm going to prove the second result I proposed you. So we work on W2, the second bad quadratic bracket. We assume that FW2 at zero is not spanned by the other vectors of the basis that involve x1 at most three times. So we can introduce a projection on Rn on fw2 of 0 parallel to this vector space F. We can apply this projection to the representation formula. Okay. As we did before, only one component remains, the one associated to the bracket w2. Okay, and the same reminder. Then I explicit this first component. We have a first part, the coordinate of the second kind, which is positive. Then we have cross terms and the same rest. Okay, and now we have to deal with this cross term. And again, I use AB smaller than A square plus B square. Okay, and I get the square of U1 and U2 that I let. And then I have the square of U3 and U4, but U3 is the primitive of U2, so I can hide them because behind some a term like that, which is the drift time some power of time. Okay, so U3 and U4, which are primitives of U1 of U2, sorry, can be bounded by this guy. Okay, so here it's quite nice. I have a first term here which is negligible when the time is small. I have another term here. You will see in two slides that it is negligible also with respect to the drift when the control is U is in small in L infinite, but it requires an interpolation inequality. So I will do it later. But the only problem here is that you have here a quantity which has no functional reasons to be negligible with respect to this guy. So again, we will prove an estimate in closed loop on this quantity by higher order terms. Okay. And how do we do exactly as we did before, okay? Just we have two terms to estimate instead of one, okay? So first we prove that the algebraic assumption we did at the beginning implies that the vectors fm naught at zero and fm1 at zero are linearly independent and span a vector space which is in direct sum with the space spanned by the other MG, the other MGs. Okay, so we can introduce a projection on this vector space parallel to the other one. Okay, we can apply this projection to the representation formula. Okay, and then you observe on this expression that you can estimate U1 and U2, which are components along linearly independent vectors. You can read on this formula that U1 and U2 are bounded by a quadratic quantity of U plus X. Okay? And then you put everything together. You start from the first formula I proved, the closed loop estimate I proved. Okay? You put everything together, you get this new expression for the projection of X on FW2 of 0. And so here, this guy is good. This guy, we are going to estimate it by Gagliardo-Nierenberg inequality. Okay, so U1 is the first primitive of U. It can, so its L4 norm can be estimated. Oh, sorry, there is a mistake. It is a square here. You have a square here and a square here. So U1 can be estimated by a product of U, which is its derivative in L infinite, and U2, which is primitive in L2. Okay? With exponent 4, 2, and 2. And if you put that inside the previous formula, this guy disappears and becomes U L infinite square times U2 L2 square. Okay? So, and now you see on this formula that it is very nice because here, if the time is small and the control is small in L infinite, this guy can be absorbed by this guy and you have a drift that prevents motions. Along minus FW2 of 0. Okay? So, of course, if you keep on working for other brackets, it will be a bit more difficult, but still the same strategy. Okay? So, if you refine this approach, you can get sharp estimates on W2. What do I mean by sharp estimate? So, here I said to you that I proved that W2 needs to be compensated by brackets involving x1 at most 3 times, but inside this long list of brackets, many can be removed. Many cannot fight against W2, and we can shorten the list. Okay, and actually the sharp list is the following one: W2 has to be compensated by brackets, linear brackets, and some very particular cubic brackets. Okay, in the sense that there are other cubic brackets that are not strong enough. Huh? So we can produce a list, a very sharp list. This result was proved by Koski, and we proved it again with our new approach. We can do the same work for W3, okay, so the third quadratic, okay, with a sharp list. And what is interesting in this result is that the sharp list seems to be very complementary with some positive controllability result proved by Agrachev and Saric, Agrachev and Gram-Kellit. So for some subclasses of systems, it's almost as if we had necessary and sufficient conditions. Okay. Okay, so we can go further and study WM infinite STLC. Okay, and prove that WK, the K-th quadratic obstruction, has to be compensated by some brackets that involve X1 at most some number of times that is completely explicit. Okay, so and we can also prove quartic and sextic necessary conditions. Okay, just by using the same approach and adapting it. Okay, so to conclude about control affine systems in finite dimension. We have proposed the methodology ingredients to prove necessary conditions for small time local controllability. It relies on an approximate formula for the state from the FB of zero. It also relies on a new whole basis of L of X, designed for this purpose. It did not exist before we invented it. I did not explain it this fact because it's quite technical and algebraic, but I hope that now you will be willing to learn about whole bases. And it also uses interpolation inequalities to absorb reminders by a coercive sign-in drift and the smallness assumption on the control. So you see that finally, to prove necessary conditions for control, you have to do algebra, geometry, and analysis, and all of them are necessary. Some perspectives. So here I prove just necessary conditions. There is a long-standing open problem which consists in finding a basis of the freely algebra that splits into good and bad brackets. Okay, so this is a long-standing open problem. We solved it up to the quartic level. So we found a basis of the freely algebra for which the elements with n1 equal 1, n1 equal 3 are all good, n1 equal 2 are all bad, and in n1 equal 4, some are good, some are bad. Okay, and we can prove complementary positive and negative results. So up to the level n1 equal 4, we have solved, in some sense, this open problem, but it remains open in full generality. Okay, and there are also perspectives about multi-input systems that Théo Jardawi is working on. Okay, and the last part in 1 minute will be to present a transfer of this technology to PDE, which is the Balinard-Schrödinger equation. Okay, so the Balinard-Schrödinger equation is the Schrödinger equation posed on an interval with directly boundary conditions and a bilinear control U, okay, acting on the state psi through a dipolar moment mu, okay, which models the interaction between the electric field U and the particle wave function. Okay, so this is a very well known and much used model in quantum control. Okay, so for this equation, we have a ground state, which is an equilibrium trajectory that you may think it corresponds to the point zero. The point zero for control-affine system was an equilibrium, and here you may think as the ground state as an equilibrium. Okay. Okay, so depending on the assumptions on mu, the system may be controllable or not in some functional space or in another functional space. For each function mu, you have a new question. Okay, so depending on the function mu, you may have several behaviors. So first, you may be able to prove controllability by the linear test. We did it with Camille Laurent a long time ago. And then you may, for other functions mu, you may lose the direction. So have a linearized system that control almost every direction except one. And in this direction, you try to use nonlinear techniques. Okay, so in this situation, Megan Bournisou was able to prove all the quadratic obstructions that are known in finite dimension. Okay, so she formulated assumptions on the function mu, under which we observe all the quadratic obstruction known in finite dimension with a functional setting very similar. Okay, so of course, she could not use the Magnus representation formula because this representation formula was proved for ODEs, and the proof really relies on the finite dimensional set. Okay, so it does not work for PDEs. But what we can do for PDEs is writing a Taylor expansion, and inside the Taylor expansion, reorganize the terms so that we recover the terms from our representation formula. Okay, we reorganize the terms, we get the Lie brackets, and we have all the terms that we have to deal with that were in the small o of x of our representation formula. Okay. Okay, but the representation formula gives a strategy. Okay, we know what we are looking for. Okay, and actually, she also proved the complementary positive result So in some regimes, so for some choices of norm, you have negative, you have obstruction, and with the complementary choice of norms, she proved the positive result, and she used the cubic term to recover controllability, even if so she used the cubic term here to recover controllability, even if it is in competition with a quadratic term. So it was the first example of PDE which was controlled by nonlinear techniques in which we had a competition between a quadratic and a cubic term. So there were already, of course, PDEs for which nonlinear controllability was proved with power series expansion, but it was always the first term of the power series that was used. And here she used the second one that had to fight against the first one. Okay, so she used the cubic one that had to fight with the quadratic one. Okay. And so something that was known for ODEs and had not been extended to PDEs. Okay, so there are of course many perspectives for Schrödinger for PDEs. Does it work for other equations, for KdV, for instance, for which we know quadratic obstruction, and also the same question for multi-input system. That's all. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Karen Bouchard, for the nice talk. Now I ask the audience if they have a questions, they can ask her. And also the if online participant have question, they can unmute and ask her.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi. I have one question. In literature, we get to know the two types of rank condition. One is Lie algebra rank condition. Another is add rank condition. Are they same or different?
Could you repeat, please? I have a problem with the sound.
In literature, we have two types of rank condition.
Yes.
Lie algebraic rank condition, another is add rank condition. So are they different or the same?
So you are evoking two algebra conditions, the Lie algebra rank condition, which is the one I introduced, and the other
Yes.
one that I don't know. What do you mean?
That is add rank condition. So I want to know whether they are same or different.
But what is inside the second one? I don't know the second one.
I think one thing is that Lie algebra span that we
Okay.
call the Lie algebra rank condition, and another is just the span of the space that gives us the tangent space. That we call the add rank
Okay, if
condition.
you okay. Okay, so you are evoking a condition that okay, so you are speaking about tangent spaces, so I think you are working on manifolds. No?
Yes, ma'am.
So I am working, I just worked about local controllability. Okay, so when you study local controllability, even if your system is posed on a manifold, you can use a diffeomorphism and transform it on the flat space Rn. Okay, because we work locally on a manifold. Okay, so for local controllability, you can replace the manifold by the flat space Rn just by diffeomorphism. So this is why I did not speak about manifolds and tangent spaces. Okay, but so it was because I was just planning to study local controllability. But when you study global controllability for systems on manifolds, you cannot do anyone the trick with the diffeomorphism because the diffeomorphism will change at any point and you cannot do that. Okay, so for systems on manifold, you have to take care of the tangent space, okay, and the curvature, etc. So I think that the answer to the question to your question is the two conditions are the same, okay. And I did not use a manifold because I was working on local controllability. Okay.
Okay, ma'am. There's one more question. I think I missed something. So we have this Sussman's rank condition that we use, Lie algebra rank condition. So why do we need this particular extra calculations to show controllability?
I did not prove controllability. I proved obstructions to controllability. Okay, so okay. I said it at the beginning. So my course today was about necessary conditions for small time local controllability. Okay, not sufficient conditions though. So you cited Sussman. So Sussman did two famous things. One thing was the first proof of, okay, sorry. Sussman did two things, one positive result and one negative result. Okay, so he proved, sorry, he gave the first proof of this result, okay? And he had a strategy to prove that, that was ex generalized then by Stefani and relies on the chain-free expansion of the state. And the drawback of this approach is that nobody has been able for many years to use this technology to prove other necessary conditions. Okay, the technology they used was nice. It was the first one, and it gave this result, but it was not so nice to prove other results and to work on PDE. So we needed a new representation formula, which was not the chain-free formula, to see the relation between the state and the Lie brackets evaluated at zero, to be able to conjecture things and prove things. Okay, so Sussman did two things. He proved this obstruction, and I chose not to present his proof and to present mine. Okay, because I think mine allows to go further. Okay, and he also proved a positive result, and I did not speak at all today of a positive controllability result. So the S Sussman S de theta condition, it was not the topic of the course. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Is there any other question? Okay, I have two questions. One is related to that when you are showing that there are some obstruction phenomena in the yesterday lecture also and today, this control U, can I take as a non-linear feedback and get the obstruction can be, I should say that one, I can get the reachability in that case. Those kind of obstruction can be destroyed by a non-linear kind of feedback.
What do you mean by nonlinear feedback? You mean U of X?
The u of t, if I can consider as a function f of xt.
Okay, you instead of U of T, you want to put U of X and of X and T. Okay?
X of t.
Oui, X of T. Oui. Okay, so the obstruction we proved together is a drift. So we prove that any control U that is small in small some norm, for any control U which is small in some norm, you have a drift. Okay, so whatever it is, a control U of T, a control U of X of T. Okay,
So
so
that means you.
in some sense, it can give obstructions to feedback control problems. Okay.
That means adding non-linearity into the system, it will not improve the directions which are missed or some obstruction you got. That's all you're saying.
No,
Because
because you are okay. So you are speaking about feedback invariance. So if you take a system, you put a feedback in it, you get another system. Because
yes.
when you put a when you look at x naught equal f naught of x plus u of t f1 of x, and then you replace u of t by something like v of x plus w of t. And you change the F naught when you do that. Okay, so you get a new system.
Yes.
Okay, and both systems have need to have the same controllability property because they are equivalent. They have the same trajectories. Okay, so there is a concept of feedback invariance. Okay, in control theory, in the sense that two controls which are equivalent have the same trajectory, so they have the same controllability property. So it is expected that conditions for controllability would be feedback invariant. Okay? And the truth is that some of them are and some others are not. For instance, this one is feedback invariant. This one is not. Okay. But okay, we need to progress. Okay. So the final goal will be to have. Okay. If one day we had a necessary and sufficient condition for small type controllability, if such a condition exists, it will be feedback invariant. Okay? But we do not know any necessary and sufficient condition. We know necessary condition, we know sufficient condition. Okay? And we try to reduce the gap between both. Okay? So, of course, we would like to have necessary conditions which are feedback invariant, necessary conditions which are feedback invariant, because then we would have more hope. Okay? But actually, that's still not the case. Some of them, among all the necessary conditions I presented, some of them are feedback invariant and some others are not.
Okay.
Okay.
And just another thing, that when you show one theorem that is corresponding to the two systems are diffeomorphic, can you go to that slide?
Yes.
Yes, yes. So in this case, actually, by a single control, you can control both the components of the system, both the different systems, right?
Yes, the two systems are diffeomorphic. It means that any trajectory of the first one is the image by a diffeomorphism of the same trajectory of the trajectory of the second one with the same control.
With the same control. That means this is sometimes when we study the simultaneous controllability. This is a similar type of situation, right? But for a nonlinear one.
I don't understand your remark.
Simultaneous controllability. So this is usually used for the linear system in that level. And if you have a simultaneous controllability, then it can help you for a coupled one using a single control. Because you are able to do that by a two different uncoupled system by a single one. So it can, in the linear model, it helps. But that's why I want to know that, is there anything that if you have a coupled system like this, this type of results has an influence that one component, if you put a control and get the controllability result?
I did not understand the question.
No.
But this is a very this theorem is a very old result by Krenner. It is not something that we use. It is something. It is not something that is used concretely. It is used to figure out what in which quantity the small time local controllability can be encoded.
Okay, so because my question is in that from here, this system, there are two different equations, but same control is acting here.
Mm-hmm.
So the question what I'm asking, if there is a relation between this one, and suppose you have the x dot and y dot, both are coupled, and you have a single control. Is there any variance of this, that this type of system, when it is coupled and by a single component control, we can get a controllability by this type of theorem?
I don't see the link.
Okay.
Thank you. Maybe we should discuss more. Sorry.
Okay. So if there is no other questions, then let us thanks Professor Kirin Buchar again.
Thanks.